Welcome. My name is Olivia Mattis, and I would like to welcome you to today's program on behalf of the Sousa Mendes Foundation. And of course, I want to wish all of you a glorious and beautiful Mother's Day. And I'm so grateful that you're spending 1 hour of your Mother's Day with us. And I think you won't regret it. It's going to be quite a remarkable hour. So we've been holding these programs every Sunday for over a year now, and they seem to be very popular. Today is no exception, so you're in for quite a treat. I've been wanting for quite some time to do a program with the Jewish Partisan Educational Foundation, directed by Mitch Braff, whom I admire so much. And I'm so grateful to him for agreeing to co-present and co-host with me today. So without further ado, I'd like to present today's moderator, the director of the Jewish Partisan Educational Foundation, Jewish Partisan Educational Foundation, Mr. Mitch Braff. Mitch, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Olivia. And we're a huge, huge fan of the work you do at the Sousa Mendes Foundation. It's really, we're really excited to work with you today on this, which is going to be an amazing program. So my name is Mitch Braff. Olivia said I'm the founder and director of JPEF, the Jewish Partisan Educational Foundation, which I founded 21 years ago. And I would say just over 21 years ago, I had no idea what a Jewish partisan was. And I met someone who was a partisan who had an incredible story who really captured my imagination. And I realized there was a need to tell the story because the Holocaust is really incomplete without learning about the approximately 30,000 Jews who escaped ghettos and camps and villages from at least 10 European countries, including people like Faye Schulman, and not only saved thousands of Jewish lives, but destroyed thousands of German convoys and derailed train cars. And it was just an amazing story that really wasn't part of Holocaust history. So in 2000, when the organization was started, we had a mandate to interview 50 surviving partisans. And we then put all of their stories online on the website, jewishpartisans.org. And we also have now over 30,000 teachers around the world, impacting over 1 million students each year to teach about the history and the life lessons of the Jewish partisans. And through that process, I was lucky enough to interview over 45 of the partisans we have in our archive. And in 2005, I was doing research and I came across this amazing partisan. Her name is Faye Schulman. And she was in a wonderful documentary film, Daring to Resist, Three Women Face the Holocaust. And I cannot believe there was a partisan photographer. I fell in love with photography similar to Faye did when I was young, when I was in the sixth grade. And like Faye, we both kind of had this fascination with watching pictures automatically develop and in the dark room and spending time with this. And I should say, when I was a photographer, or still a photographer, I have a decent eye, but Faye, on the other hand, has a really extraordinary eye. And in doing the research about who this photographer was in 2005, I came across this and other photos. And what's extraordinary about this photo is that the composition is amazing. And it really just, you know, Faye is more than just someone taking snapshots. She was really a true photographer. And what's amazing then about this is that she was developing negatives and printing in the forest, which is really incredible. And you know, what's also amazing about her photos and what we're going to show a little more today is that she kept these were mementos for her. And because when she was taking these pictures, she had no idea that she would survive the war and her photographs would. So when she left and her family ultimately, her and her husband and her daughter immigrated to Canada, they took as many photos as they could. So she kept photos that included herself. And this is one of my favorite photos. It's very iconic. Here are four Jews during the Holocaust. And when we think of that idea of Jews during the Holocaust, this is an extraordinary photo. I sometimes like to joke around that if I said that this photograph was actually taken from a Bing Crosby, Bob Hope Road movie from the 1950s, I think some people would believe. The composition's beautiful. Faye would set this up on a tripod, look through the lens, compose it, and then have someone else press the shutter. But I really think that we're very lucky to have these photographs because it really changes our understanding of the Jewish experience during the Holocaust, because Faye really was an embedded photographer. And she was there with her camera, giving us perspectives of what it was like. And so Matt, if you can go back to the other picture, this photograph, and it's Faye's brother, third from the left, this photograph here shows Jews in the forest. This is people in a family camp. These aren't fighters. These are people who are hiding and trying to save their lives there. And it's just a beautiful composition of a photo, but it also, because she was, if you will, embedded with the partisan group, she gave us perspective of Jewish life and also partisan life during the Holocaust that no one has really ever shown before Faye. And as you know, as today, you know, we're so lucky to have her, you know, her incredible body of work here. And I should say that we're very sad also for Faye's passing on April 24th. May her memory be a blessing. She was 101 years old, and we give condolences to all of her family. As this is Mother's Day, Faye was not just a mother, but a mother and a grandmother. And I wanted to take this moment on behalf of Olivia as well to honor all Jewish women who survived the Holocaust, the millions of children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren they all have today. Today, I'm actually joined by two incredible women, plus a third woman, a surprise guest. We have JOANNE D.GILBERT and Shelley Saywell. JOANNE is a writer and Shelley is a filmmaker. And we also have Rochelle Schulman, Faye's granddaughter, who's gonna speak about Faye later in the program. At about 40, 45 minutes of the program, we'll have time for Q&A. If you have any questions, please put them in the chat, in the message, and Olivia will answer them, will have us answer them for us. It is my pleasure now to introduce JOANNE D.GILBERT. JOANNE is the author and educator whose work celebrates young women who successfully defied the Nazis and their collaborators during the Holocaust. Her friendship with Faye began in 2012 when Faye agreed to be interviewed for JOANNE's book, Women of Valor, Polish Jewish Resistors in the Third Reich. JOANNE, take it away.
Thanks for that wonderful introduction. And thank you, Susan Mendez Foundation, for making it possible for all of us to come today and celebrate Faye Schulman. All of us who have known Faye have different routes to come to her. And mine began when I was little, and similar to Mitch, I didn't know that the Jews fought. I'd only heard that the Jews went silently like sheep to the slaughter. And I couldn't accept that. I couldn't believe that they didn't fight. I especially couldn't believe that Jewish women did not fight their oppressors. In 2012, I was finally able to search for the answer to my question, and to meet women that I call women of valor who absolutely did fight back. Faye, everyone knew about Faye. I called all over the country and Canada in order to see if anyone knew who I should talk to. And I finally got through to the JCC in Toronto, and they said, oh yes, we know exactly who you should talk to. It's Faye Schulman, and here's her phone number. And so I called her right away, and she loved that I was trying to show that the Jews fought, because that was the basis of her dedication in her life. And so she invited me to her apartment. I bought a ticket immediately to Toronto. And when I got to the building, she buzzed me in. I went up the elevator. And as I walked through the long, dimly lit hall to her apartment, I tried to gather my thoughts, knowing that I was going to be meeting this amazing woman. And just as I was ready to knock, the door opened and light flooded through the doorway and lit up Faye's face and her hair. And here I have a few shots showing Faye through the ages. You can see the beauty and her riveting gaze, no matter what her age. When she opened that door, the sunlight behind her lit up her hair in a glorious cloud. and it looked like she was being delivered by a sunbeam. I never forgot that initial feeling of seeing Faye coming through that sunlight. At 93, at that time, Faye still radiated the calm and the confidence that I know must have given solace to her patients and strength to her comrades, and even caused a Nazi commandant to smile. She welcomed me in, gave me water, and made sure I was comfortable, and then sat down. It was like two girlfriends continuing a conversation that we'd left off with some weeks before. And as she spoke, telling me her story, I could see her 93-year-old frame transforming into that of a young, strong, fierce Jewish woman warrior. As she spoke, I could also see the agony and her grief of the 6 million who had perished, including most of her family. What was especially clear was her emphasis on the fact that the Jews fought back. There was resistance. It wasn't all victimhood. For Faye, never forget, wasn't just a slogan. It was the way she lived her life. And she shared that with audiences, thousands of people, well into her 90s. Again, as we celebrate Mother's Day, I'm particularly honored to share a few of the stories with you that she shared with me. We're going to start with her family. And in the upper right-hand corner, you see her parents, Rizal and Yaakov Lizebnik. And this was their wedding photo. And Faye told me how much she loved looking at it because it showed them when they were young and energetic. She then mentioned what it was like watching them be worn down by the occupation, to see them age so quickly and to become frail. Tragically, her father was murdered when he was 54 and her mother when she was 52. In the right-hand family group program, we see them gathered together to celebrate the imminent departure of Yaakov's brother, who with his family was about to emigrate to Palestine. And in the upper left corner, we see Faye with a kind of strange expression on her face. And I think maybe either Moish set the photo up on a timer or someone else was taking the picture. And Faye, knowing as much as she did about photography, was nervous that maybe the shot wouldn't be successful. During Faye's early years, she had many, many responsibilities. And one of them was to help her mother run a little restaurant in the house. They needed financial help, and her mother just stepped forward. She was a wonderful cook and started this tiny restaurant. And what was interesting was that at that time, where they lived was Lenin, a little town on the border with the Soviet Union. And the Polish military was there and the Soviet military was there, and they didn't like each other officially, but unofficially they got along. And they got along especially when they came together in Rizal's restaurant to enjoy the Jewish cooking and the beer that she sold them. Faye assisted her mom and learned all about running a restaurant. At the same time, she was also an assistant to her brother Moish, a photographer, who taught her many of the skills that she would use later in the partisans. And one of the skills she picked up on her own was color tinting of the black and white photos. There hadn't been color film, so she took a portrait, it was in black and white, and then she would by hand tint it to beautiful tones that thrilled her customers. One in particular she would meet a little later. She earned enough money helping her brother run his business and helping her mother with the restaurant that one day she was actually able to buy a fabulous leopard fur coat and hat. She purchased it from one of the Russian trucks that had come over the border bringing goods to the market. She loved that coat, and there's quite a story about it. I think you might have spotted it in Mitch's first two slides. So there they were living their regular life. It was fairly comfortable under Soviet control. But when the Germans broke the Molotov-Ribbentrop pact, the Polish military took off, the Soviet military took off, and the Nazis invaded, and everything changed. They confiscated all of the valuables, including Faye's gorgeous coat. Apparently, they had advanced knowledge of who the useful Jews in the community were and where they lived. They knew there was a carpenter. They knew there was a metal worker. They knew a machinist. They knew a seamstress. And of course, they knew there was a photographer. One day, Faye had and her family were doing some work inside the house, and they heard the dreaded sound of the heavy Nazi boots coming toward their doorway. And they held their breath, turned around, and saw the commandant standing there, huge in his uniform and boots, with his riding crop ready to hit anybody who annoyed him. And he looked around and said, "Who's the photographer?" Well, Moish wasn't there. And Faye, a teenager, turned around, looked at him, and said, "I'm the photographer." And he said, "Good. I want a photo taken. I want it ready in an hour. And I want it to look good." Well, how do you define what looks good to a Nazi? So Faye set about taking his picture. She took it into the dark room to be developed, and she saw that he looked horrible. And she had the chutzpah to go back out to him and say, "The first one didn't work out. Could we take a second one? And would you smile this time?" So here's this little Jewish girl confronted with a Nazi and telling him to smile, and he did. And the photo came out well, and he liked it so much that he made her the official photographer. Many of the Germans wanted her to take portraits so that they could and color them so that they could send them back to their sweethearts. Part of the job, however, was for Faye to develop the film of the atrocities that the Nazis were engaged in. While she was doing this, she had the presence of mind to make duplicate sets of these films and to bury them around Lenin so that there would be proof. If anybody survived and if anybody could find them, there would be proof. She also had the foresight to bury camera equipment and supplies, as well as some of the family photos that she had found in her house. The Germans allowed her to leave their office and go to her house to use that dark room. And they made sure that her house was empty while she was doing that. Well, one day they brought her a Ukrainian girl and said, "Oh, Faye, you're working so hard. We think you need an assistant." And Faye knew that that was code for, "You're about to not be useful anymore. You're about to be replaced." And so while she was training the little girl, she deliberately told her the wrong thing. She left something out of the recipe for the developer, or she took out a little component of the camera. And it just took that little Ukrainian girl so long to learn. And during that time, Faye sped up her stealing of the equipment and burying of the supplies. Let's see. Eventually, there was a roundup that is coming August 14th, 1942, and the Germans came and they rounded up all of the Jews of Lenin. And during the chaos and the horror of the roundup, the commandant happened to saunter through, and out of the corner of his eye, he spotted Faye with her family. And he ordered someone to pull her out and pull her aside. And he put her in a little group with a few other Jews. It turns out those would be the 26 people who were let to live because they could serve the Germans. Faye begged him to let her die with her family, but he refused. The 26 Jews were then incarcerated in the synagogue, where they were forced to stay when they weren't being useful. One night, there was a great noise outside, and a partisan was at the door. He was able to get their attention and break through the door. And he said, "You all better run. There's going to be a terrible raid, and they'll probably set fire to the synagogue. Please escape. And they gathered their stuff, and Faye gathered what she could, and she hooked up with a couple of other partisans, and they then spent hours sludging through the forest, the snow, the water, until they finally got to their camp. And Faye was so relieved when she spoke to the commandant that he already knew she was a photographer, and he was particularly delighted to have her because he knew that her brother-in-law was a doctor. So he assumed that Faye had learned from a doctor and could be a nurse. The truth was, Faye knew nothing about being a nurse, and she hated the sight of blood. But being Faye, she just stepped right up, learned what she had to do, and became an outstanding nurse. One night, while she was in the partisans, they got a signal that they would be attacking Lenin. And the commandant said to Faye, look, you're new here. We're going to raid and probably destroy your whole city. You don't have to go. You could stay back. And she said, no, I know the city back and forth. I will be valuable in terms of guiding people, and it's my responsibility to go. And so they trudged again through the night for hours back to Lenin, and they took up their position. And on a signal before daybreak, they attacked the city. All the Germans were still living, still sleeping in the homes that they had commandeered. And it was a brutal fight. And at one point, for some reason, there was a lull. And during the lull, Faye said, hey, let's go over to my house. Maybe there'll be some equipment there. And they went, and no, there wasn't any equipment. And she said, maybe the Ukrainian girl took the equipment. It's probably at her house. And so her comrades looked at her, and they said, Faye, we've got to burn this house down. Why don't you walk away? And she said, no, it's my house. I'm going to burn it down. And they gave her the match. She lit it and watched her beautiful childhood home and all of her happy, loving memories turn into ashes. And as the house was burning, she said, let's go over to the Ukrainian girl's house, as if they were taking a regular Sunday walk. And they did. They walked over to the Ukrainian girl's house, and outside on the curb, they saw boxes. And they looked in the boxes, and it was the equipment that the Ukrainian girl had taken from the dark room. The family had put it outside. While they were looking at it and deciding how to pick it up and carry it back to the forest, a strange woman started walking toward them. Now it's foggy, it's ashy, it's smelly, there's gunshots, there's fire. It's a catastrophe. And here's this lady walking down the street toward them, and no one said a word. And as she passed them by, she handed a heavy bundle to Faye and kept walking. And Faye opened the bundle up, and it was her fur coat. She got it back that night. This is one of her beautiful shots of her comrades that she set up on a tripod. And as Mitch has told us, the quality of this photo is extraordinary. She had special film. And the detail Matt's about to show you, that you can see all of their uniforms, so-called, are different. They just wore what they could find, beg, borrow, or steal. Same thing with their weapons. Often they had to construct weapons from spare parts of other weapons. And they often did raids into the town to steal their weapons. Faye always said that when she went into combat, she took three things. She took her medical kit, which you can see over her right shoulder. And she took her gun, and she took her camera. And we found an advertisement for the kind of camera she had. You can take a look at that camera. Here's one of the first formal photos that she took. You can see how beautifully it's composed. The horizontals are parallel. The verticals of the trees are almost parallel. And the beautiful, shiny, brand new, state-of-the-art weapons that they had just stolen from the Germans are the center of attraction. Beautiful photo of Faye, who didn't really have formal training, but with everything she did it beautifully. Here we have the coat and she is posing again. And Matt showed the shot of her with her comrades earlier in the presentation. And in this one, she's showing us her beautiful form and her beautiful coat. A few days after her, after the raid where her home was burned down, Faye and her friends went back to see what was left. And again, they found the smoldering, charred ruins of her once beautiful childhood home. Again, the composition is breathtaking. You see the verticals in the back of the remaining chimneys. You see the verticals of the four comrades in front of the tree, which is shaped like a V behind them. Further, you see in the foreground, so striking, the graves of three German Christian soldiers. Here's another outstanding photo from her partisan days. Faye and the surgeon, who is a veterinarian, were doing surgery, providing medical care to another partisan who had been shot. You can see behind them that they are being protected by another partisan because there is fire going on. There are shots coming out toward them. After the war, Faye became a wonderful artist and painted this portrait of that event in oil. It's a massive piece of art and it's on a wall in her apartment. Another outstanding photo, so fascinating. Look at what's going on here. They are doing surgery in the middle of the forest. Look at their operating table. Look at what they're wearing. What they did was they went on raids to neighboring towns and neighboring hospitals, and they stole whatever they needed. And they made makeshift operating tables and stretchers out of whatever wood was available. If you look at the man in the background behind the nurse, his head is all, other side, Matt, thanks. His head is all bandaged. Faye had just finished bandaging her head, and then she came and set up this shot of this particular surgery. You can see her, she's smiling, not because she's happy, but because that moment of getting that shot. They were eventually liberated by the Soviets and under Soviet control for a while. And then they escaped the Soviets and ended up in Landsberg, displaced persons camp in Germany. Faye had found her brother Moish, and he coincidentally had his close friend Morris with him. And Faye and Morris fell in love. Look at that picture. Look at those faces. I mean, as the word Shane upon him was made for those faces. They're glorious. And of course, she still has the coat. A few years later, they married and became, look at them, became the proud, loving parents of their precious daughter, Susan, in 1946. Before Susan was born, they had wanted to go to Israel, and they had been extremely active in smuggling arms for Palestine. By the time it was time to go, however, they were parents and decided it was too dangerous with the 48 war, and they emigrated to Canada. When I visited Faye for the first time, I had the audacity as a non-professional photographer to ask her if I could take a photo of her with a photo from when she was in high school. And look what she showed me. She had colorized this photo. Mm-hmm. It's in a book that her family put together, a memory book. And I felt like she must have felt telling the Nazi to smile, me telling Faye to pose. But I'm so glad that I did it. It's a very beautiful shot. Mm-hmm. In 2014, I was honored to make a presentation to the Toronto Jewish Genealogy Society. And of course, I invited Faye to join me. She was thrilled to be able to bring her story to over 150 people in the audience. And as always, she emphasized her credo. And again, here it is. There was resistance. The Jews did not go silently like sheep to the slaughter. I was a photographer. I was there. I have the pictures. I have proof. And because of Faye Schulman, I have proof. Mm. As a Faye Schulman, the world has proof.
Thank you, Joanne, so much.
Over to you.
Thank you, Joanne. That was very, very powerful. Thank you. I would really like to, excited to introduce amazing Canadian documentary filmmaker, Shelley Saywell, who made Out of the Fire with Faye. And we're gonna have her come on and speak a little. And Shelley, when you come up, I'd like you to talk about how you first met Faye.
Thanks, Mitch. Thank you for inviting me. I'm so honored. Faye was larger than life. I met her because I wrote a book called Women in War when I was very young, and nobody was telling the stories of women in war. We didn't know very much about women's experience in the front lines. In fact, I think they'd been written out of history. So I traveled the world. I went to the former Soviet Union. I went all over collecting these stories. And there in my hometown in Toronto was Faye Schulman, but I didn't know about her. I didn't find her until the book came out. My book comes out, and about 6 months later, there's this little article in a local newspaper, Faye Schulman watercolor exhibit, because of her many talents, she was also an incredible artist. This little community paper said, you know, almost as an aside, that she'd been a partisan in World War II. So I got on the phone, I called her up. She and Morris invited me to their home in Etobicoke. And I visited them, I had coffee with them. I gave them a copy of my book. And I said, I'm so upset that I didn't know about you. When I was doing all this research, you have the most incredible story I've ever heard. And they were just so lovely. We sat in their living room, they were holding hands. They really hadn't shared their story with the world. She had thought about it. She'd been asked to do it, but she was really, really hesitant about it. And we stayed in touch and we stayed friends for 14 years. And all through those years, she would call me or I would call her, you know, every 6 months or every year. And how are you? And I'd say, have you thought any more about your story? And she was resistant. She just wasn't ready. After Morris died, she decided it was time. And I approached her again and I had a broadcaster and I had the money. And I said, Faye, everybody wants you to tell your story. And she said, okay, I'll do it. How long is the film? I said, it's an hour. She said, okay, come to my house. We'll talk for 2 hours and you'll have extra. I said, Faye, you're a photographer. You know, it's going to take much more than that to do justice to your story. But she didn't want to go back. She didn't want to go back to the killing field. She didn't want to go back to Lenin. She didn't want to see what was still there. She never wanted to set foot there again. So I said, all right, I will make the film anyway. We'll just interview you. We'll use these incredible photographs. But I will send my researcher to Belarus, what is now Belarus, to see what is there, and we would get extra footage. And so my lovely Christina Senyuk, our wonderful colleague and researcher, went and did this 3-week recce and went back to Lenin and found photographs of Faye's that Faye didn't have anymore that were in the museums there, found partisans, but most importantly went back to Lenin and went to the site of the mass grave and picked some flowers and brought them back. We visited Faye and Christina had pressed the flowers and she said, I know you'll never go back, here are flowers from the grave, and Faye said, I'm going, I have to go. So that was the beginning of our journey back. And I have to say, of all the films I've ever made, it was the most bittersweet. It was the most joyous. She's an incredible woman on every level. Inspired us every day. We just rolled. It was completely organic. She just told her story. And we were experiencing it with her because she had no idea what she was going to find. It was a very moving experience.
It's a really beautiful film. And I know we love it. And hopefully most people were able to see it before. I know there was a clip you wanted to show. Could you introduce the clip and talk a little bit about it, Shelley?
Yes, you know, there's so many clips I could have chosen, but I chose this one because this is where Faye reunites with another girl in the partisan that fought with her, that lived with her in the forest for 3.5 years, and who escaped the same night from Lenin with her. And they haven't seen each other in 55 years. And Rosie's got her granddaughters there, and Faye's telling Rosie's granddaughters who their grandmother was. So here's the clip.
This is Rosa. This is your mother-in-law and your grandmother. And this is in the partisans. And I don't have this picture, even though I took it, heroine. And I meet, she has medals, of course. And look at your grandmother. Now 55 years have passed, and Rosa is here. We weren't dreaming about that we will ever meet again. And so many of our friends that we were fighting together against the enemy, many passed away. Only a few survived after so many years. So it's really hard to believe, and like Rosie says, it went like a dream, like one dream, like yesterday, like it just happened now. It's hard to believe that already so many years, a lifetime.
Спали в одной землянке, на одной, на одних нарах вместе.
We slept together on the ground for years, for months, in the same place.
That led into a scene of their life in the forest with the partisans. We took Faye back to Lenin. It was 10 days of the most remarkable sense that I was bearing witness to history, to this remarkable, extraordinary woman. And she says in the film, I live with memory, but she also lived for her family and for the future, and her bravery and her resistance was about making a future for her people and her community and her family. And I'm so thrilled, and I just found out before we started today, that her granddaughter, Rochelle Schulman, is part of this program. So I am now going to pass it to you, Rochelle.
Hi, everyone. I'm supposed to talk about a memory, but I can't pick just one. So instead, I'm going to talk about a feeling. Every time she saw me or heard my voice, her excitement and love would touch my soul. The love that she had for her grandchildren was so strong. She had a way in making me feel more loved than anyone in the world. And I will forever cherish my bubby's embracing hugs. And currently right now, I'm sitting here in her den. This has been her home as long as I can remember. Whenever I would come and visit her, this would be my bedroom. And I've been taking the last couple of weeks and going through all the little hidden gems that she has in here. And she's touched so many lives. I found thank you notes as far back as 1988, speeches she wrote from the 70s. And I feel so touched by all the lives that my bubby had an impact. And what you are all doing here today is such a mitzvah for her, because all she wants is her story to be told and for us to never forget. So thank you all very much for having me, and you are all making her very proud.
Rochelle, thank you so much for sharing this, and it's so touching to have you, especially in her apartment. So thank you for making time and sharing part of Faye with all of us today. We are grateful. So thank you, Olivia. I know that we've been getting lots of questions during this program, and I think that we probably have time for them. So if you want to ask a question, and then between Shelley and Joanne and myself, we'll do our best to answer it.
Fantastic. We'll get to Q&A in just a few moments. Right now, I want to tell you a little bit about our upcoming programs, and then we'll turn to your questions. So after today's program, you will get an email with information about signing up for our upcoming programs. Next week, we are featuring the story of a woman named Noor Inayat Khan, who also was a woman war hero of World War II. She was a Sufi Muslim. Her father was from India. Her mother was American. She grew up in Paris and London. She ended up being a spy for the British. She went into France and was a radio operator there. She ultimately was captured and was murdered at Dachau, and her last word was liberté. There's a best-selling book about her life called Spy Princess, and we have the author of that book, Shrabani Basu, with us next week. And we also have Noor's cousin, who is an actual sheikh, a Muslim sheikh, who has direct memories of Noor. He's in his mid-90s, and it's going to be a fabulous program. So I do hope you sign up for that. Just like today, it is a free program. And also just like today, we have books available. So we have the book Spy Princess for next week. And for this week, we have a couple of books. We have Joanne's book called Women of Valor. And I think we have a slide with a couple of book covers. So we have JOANNE D.GILBERT's book, Women of Valor, where Faye Schulman is featured in one of the chapters. And then we have Faye's own memoir, a partisan's memoir, where you can read her story in her own words. And so that's next week is Spy Princess. So you'll have information about that. Then the following week, we're featuring the story of the composer, Felix Mendelssohn, who was the grandson of the great Jewish theologian Moses Mendelssohn. But Felix, the composer, converted to Lutheranism. His parents converted him when he was a child. His music reflects the Lutheran tradition and the Jewish tradition. 100 years later, when the Nazis came to power, they banned Mendelssohn's music. They also reclassified all of his descendants from Lutheran or whatever they were to Jewish, and they were persecuted as Jews. One of these descendants is the British filmmaker Sheila Heyman. So she tells the remarkable story of Mendelssohn's music, her family story, and herself. It's called Mendelssohn, the Nazis, and Me. And here is just a brief trailer for that film.
Felix Mendelssohn's Wedding March may be the best-known tune in the world. Until 1934, it blessed marriages all over Germany. But under the Nazis, playing any piece of Mendelssohn could cost you your life.
I was 10 years old and my piano teacher gave me Mendelssohn's Lieder ohne Worte, and she told me, if you practice it, please close your window because the music is forbidden.
This film is about what happened to Mendelssohn's music when the Nazis came to power, and why Felix, the German national treasure, was also a Jew.
They had the idea that the German nation was an organism which needed to be cured. They wanted to use science to define who a Jew was.
Do you have Jewish earlobes?
I'm not sure. I don't think anyone's ever looked at my earlobes with sufficient attention.
The Nazis tried to define in which case the persons of a marriage could come out Jews or not, and the children of them Jews or not.
It's also the story of what happened to his family at that time.
It dawned on us gradually that the Jews were really dreadful people, but only slowly that, in some sense, I was one of them.
His less Jewish cousins, who remained in Germany, no longer had any idea who they were.
All of a sudden, I was not German any longer. I didn't belong to anything and anybody. And for a young person, it's very, very hard.
To himself, Felix may have been a religious mongrel like the rest of the family. To the Nazis, he was unquestionably a Jew. The fate of his music now became entwined with that of the whole Jewish population of Germany. And when the Jews were sent to the camps, they took Mendelssohn with them. This propaganda film begins with Elijah. It was the last music many of them heard before they were transported to Auschwitz. I'm Sheila Heyman, a filmmaker, and I want to find out why Mendelssohn was so important to the Nazis and why the family found themselves caught up in a forgotten crisis of identity that began with Felix himself. Because that family is also mine. Felix Mendelssohn was my great-great-great-great uncle.
So please join us for that program and the other ones to come. So now let's get to the questions. There's a question for Shelley Saywell, which is about the moving images that were in your film. The film images, where did they come from?
I assume the question would be about the archival, the black and white footage. We combed the archives in Minsk. The Soviets did a remarkable job of filming during the Second World War, and they shot often in 35 millimeter, and that footage is a treasure trove. So we spent quite a bit of time looking for images that either from that area or that just reflected the partisan life in the forests and the incredible scorched earth atrocities perpetrated by the Nazis, not only against the Jews, but the whole villages. I think there were something like 9,000 villages razed to the ground by the Nazis. So there is a record of it, Faye's photographs, and that archive helped us help her tell her story.
So now there's a question I don't know who wants to answer, but the question is, who took the photographs that Faye herself is in?
I can take a stab at it. I don't think that we know specifically the one person, perhaps, who was taking the photos with Faye. It is my understanding, and everyone else, our other speakers, Rochelle as well, if you have other insights, let me know. But she had a tripod and she could set it up and set up the exposure and focus it. And then she could basically at that point have someone else press the shutter. This was way before selfies, and the camera was a medium format, 2-inch negative with a relatively slow film. So this had to be on a tripod in most cases, because the beating of your heart would shake the camera and it would be blurry. So I don't know who the person was, but she would set the shots up. My guess it would be several different people who were around to press the shutter.
There are a number of questions about how did she manage to bury these materials and not have them discovered by the Nazis and not have them ravaged by the elements? How did that work? Can any of you answer that?
I don't have any specifics on how she buried them, other than that they were buried. My guess is she would have to put them in some type of bag or enclosure so the dirt and the water and the moisture wouldn't destroy them. I don't think animals would. I don't think the scent would attract animals like something like that would dig it up. But it's something that she had to hide. But it's quite extraordinary. She also had the presence to bury it, because when they went on partisan missions, they really couldn't leave it there. There were no lockers or any place to put anything.
And how did she continue to find film? And how did she develop the film?
Yes, she, the partisans kept raiding towns and villages. And I mean, starting with her own, she had supplies. And what I remember, just to further on what Mitch just said, she talked about a metal box that she buried in the forest. But I think that just subsequent raids, they just would get those supplies. But she had her own chemicals that she developed, and she made makeshift darkrooms in the forest. And I think JOANNE has something to say about this too.
Well, she buried them more than once. She buried them when she was working for the Nazis, and she had freedom to walk from their office to her home to use the dark room, and she would use that time to find burial places around the edge of town. She didn't know what was going to happen next, but when what happened next happened, she was able to come back periodically and retrieve some of that equipment. She did the same thing when she was in the Partisans. She would bury it and then come back for it. So she was able to protect it from the elements. Was there more to that question?
No, but actually I wanna add one more thing about that, is that from my conversations with Faye, I recall that she says, like today, if you were still going to develop, you know, with chemicals and not just take digital, you would buy developer and stop bath and fixer. And Faye knew the different chemicals that would make the developer or the stop bath or the fixer. She couldn't go to a photo store. So when the Partisans raided, they would get the individual chemicals, and she, photographers of that era, including Faye, had to be a little bit of a chemist and know what concoction, if you will, to put that together. And she basically did this in the forest. There was no legitimate dark room. She was using it and, you know, and making and develop the negatives and then make contact prints, or she would say sun prints, either very, very briefly outside with a firelight or sometimes out very quickly direct sunlight. And so the prints would be the same size as the negative, which is approximately 2 by 2 inches.
So Mitch, there's a general question about the Partisans, and that is, how much did they know about what was going on? I mean, they were the direct witnesses to the quote unquote Holocaust by bullets, right, of the Einsatzgruppen. But the concentration camps, how much did they know about what was going on there?
To my knowledge, it was they really didn't, for the most part, because where the Partisans were not in the same geographic area as the concentration camps. They would people who would be from the ghettos and they would hear stories, but just because of the limited of communications, they didn't realize in terms of the scale of those. They would know, for instance, like in Facetown, where they would murder, you know, in that case, you know, about 800 people in pits or in Ponar outside of Vilna, Lithuania. But they didn't understand that, you know, the Auschwitz and these kind of killing centers where hundreds of thousands or a million people were killed.
Yeah. And people want to know if there's a website where more of her photos can be seen. And I think that would be your website, wouldn't it be, Mitch?
Yes. Well, thank you for that. And yeah, and that's a good segue. So yeah, so our website, www.jewishpartisans.org, you can look up Partisans, and we have photographs from Faye, just some of them. But the most exciting thing for me is that probably around 2007 or 2006, when I actually went to her home, her apartment where Rochelle is now, and I held up each photograph and I said, tell me about this picture. And she would talk about it. And I'd say, tell me about this picture. And she would talk about that. And so I'm really excited that we have some of that on the website. And if it isn't online yet, I was in preparing for this presentation, I came across a video that I made, you know, probably around 2006, 2007, with all of her photos and her talking about all of them. And if it's, I will send you the link, Olivia, that you can share with this group. And it's something that I think is, if you're interested in it, it's wonderful to hear it in her own words. And then finally, JPEF, the Jewish Partisan Educational Foundation, has a traveling photography exhibit. This is a traveling exhibit. It's been all over the world. In fact, I've taken Faye to Israel when we showed that exhibit around 2010, I think, 2009. And it's probably been about 30 different cities all over the world. And there's more information about that on the JPEF website. But that was how I came to her with JPEF, was to get her story on film in terms of her photos, but ultimately we got permission to make this wonderful exhibit. And I also wanna thank her family that was very supportive of this, and Second Story Press, which has the copyright on a lot of the photos from the memoir that you pointed. And they've always been very generous in sharing and letting us share her work.
And maybe there is time for just a few brief final thoughts from our speakers, perhaps starting with JOANNE, if you have something you'd like to say.
Oh, thank you, Olivia. What an amazing hour this has been, I think, for all of us. Thank you for making it possible. When I watch Shelley's beautiful film, and I've seen it many times, each time is like the first time. And each time I just want to reach in and touch Faye's beautiful face and give her a hug again. I'm so grateful to her for sharing her story with me. And I hope with everyone who's in the audience today that you carry her message forward, that there was resistance. The Jews did not go silently like sheep to the slaughter. Thank you.
Shelley, what would you like to say to our audience?
I think about Faye every day. I have her photograph on my wall. I've had it there for 20 years. I look at it, I see her beauty. It was taken before the war. I see her innocence. And I also know that that innocence was taken away from her, but I always feel that her strength and her spirit will live on. So I'm so grateful for having met her and having won her trust and sharing her journey in making that film.
Rochelle, is there anything you would like to add?
One thing I forgot to mention is, as I've been going all her things, I have been finding the most beautiful surprises. I found over 100 photos of life in Lenin before the war. Mm. And photos of my family. We're going to try and get those online, but it's just, she really kept everything, and it's like walking through history, being here. And I just, sorry, I'm kind of at a loss for words right now, but thank you so much, Olivia, for having me speak, and for all of you being here today. It means so much to me.
And Mitch, I think you have a little clip you'd like to share.
Yeah, so in closing then, I'll say that I'm just grateful for Faye and her generosity to me, and say all of us, I'm sure Shelley and Joanne feel the same way, that she has been approached by many people to help tell her story in different ways. And we're all very lucky that she chose us to share part of her life with. And that always really meant to me. She became a very, very good friend and knew all about my kids, and and I would always ask about them, and I feel really, really lucky. The clip that we're gonna show was, to my knowledge, it's probably the last video interview or that last video clip of Faye. JPEF had a Yom HaShoah program about 1 month ago, and we had different Jewish partisans light the different six memorial candles for that program. And what we're gonna show you is a clip with a woman, Alana Berger, who introduces Faye, and then Faye saying her name, and then lighting a candle. So I think this is a very powerful way to close and to end this. We can see it, and unfortunately, a couple weeks after this video was made, Faye passed away.
Tonight, Faye lights the fifth candle for the more than 30,000 Jews who fought back in armed resistance as Jewish partisans, saving thousands of lives and ensuring a future for the Jewish people.
My name is Faye Schulman.
Mitch, that's so touching.
Yeah, no, I was so glad that we could share this, and so really lucky to have this. And I think, again, Olivia, I want to really thank you for this, and putting this together. JPEF was thrilled to be part of it. And I think for Mother's Day, it was a very appropriate day that you chose. And again, I want to thank all of the mothers and the grandmothers and the great-grandmothers and all of this. And, this has been a wonderful time to honor Faye. So thank you, everyone. I wish everyone a wonderful day today.
Great. And of course, thank you to Shelley Saywell for her very touching film. Thank you to Joanne for all of that research and that personal relationship you developed with Faye that allowed you to tell her story so beautifully. Thank you to Rochelle for the surprise appearance. We didn't know you would be on our program until just moments ago, and I'm glad you're here. And Mitch, it's been a joy to do this with you. Maybe we'll do another program together again soon.
I hope so.
Have a wonderful Mother's Day, everyone. See you next week. Bye-bye, everybody.